Thank you to Justin for the opportunity to be here. I kind of misunderstood a Twitter exchange where I saw James talking to Justin talking about making, you know, the popularity, rising popularity of operating systems. And I thought, gee, I know a little bit about that. And next thing I knew, I was on the schedule to talk tonight. And then about a week ago, I thought I'd better actually check how technical this conference is. Turns out really technical. So I'm now in the... I spent all night writing my presentation in K, and I think I've done a reasonably good job. I'm here to talk about who am I and why am I here. My name is Jerry Carr. I am now an independent marketing consultant. I work with sort of pre-investment stage A startup companies, mostly in SaaS. I do a little bit of open source stuff still. But for a long time, I was, let me do another show of hands things. Who here knows Ubuntu? Right, thank God for that. Okay. Does anyone here work for Ubuntu? Who? Oh, you did? Okay, not anymore, though. No, we can talk freely. Well, we can talk freely. I worked for Ubuntu from 2007 to 2012. I think, consequently, we were one of Red Monk's first clients when James started working here. I led the marketing efforts basically for over 5 years. I did all of them will come to the number of different areas that Ubuntu moved into. And the first thing I should say is that I had a great time working there for a long time. It was a real privilege to be able to work at, in many ways, the sort of vanguard of bringing open source into lots of different areas where I hadn't been for a while. Obviously, again, I'll come to this in a second, Ubuntu started at desktop, but then branched into other areas. But that desktop area, in terms of awakening the PC industry to an alternative to Windows, which it got into a very, very deep and bad marriage for a very long time with, I think was a very important for all the things that have come since in terms of people's acceptance of Android and various other things. So all that was a really, really good and positive and super worthwhile use of time. But then no one wants to hear about how good things everything was. What I was hoping to do today is talk about, well, people have projects, people have startup companies. Is there anything they can learn from what we did at Ubuntu or didn't do at Ubuntu that would be useful in terms of a cautionary tale. So I think you know which way I'm going with that. The other thing I should say is I haven't worked at Ubuntu for 2 years. I left in 2012, so all my information is at least 2 years old. I don't have any current information. I don't have any insight into their current strategy or the current trajectory. All I know is what we were trying to do over those 5 years and what we maybe could have done different and what basically other people could possibly apply to what they're doing in terms of their projects and communities and startup companies. So, with all that said, what was Ubuntu trying to do? I don't know if this is what they were still trying to do. When I joined, I think everyone probably familiar with bug number one. Bug number one was this, the first bug in the Launchpad bug tracker system, which was that the majority position of Microsoft on desktop was killing innovation in the PC market. It was killing innovation in the application market. I was basically making one company rich at the expense of lots of other organizations. That was bug number one, and Ubuntu was founded to solve that bug, in essence. And that was the founding tenet for about the first 3 or 4 years. By the time I joined, that had kind of switched to being a single ubiquitous. This is my definition, by the way. I don't know why I'm reading it like it sounds like it's important. But my definition was that it wanted to be a single ubiquitous open source operating system that was at the center of the open source application universe. And that's actually pretty important because Ubuntu, the operating system, is only a very small part of the story. Really, when I joined, for instance, the Launchpad team, well, Launchpad was a code repository and a bug tracking product, and alongside it was a project called Bazaar, which was a version control system. And this combination of technologies was there in order to have the open source world coalesce around Ubuntu, to join the cadence of Ubuntu. I release every 6 months, particularly for desktop applications, and that all the world's open source code would be you would use that as its repository. That's the one place you would go if you had an open source project in order to drive it. And that Ubuntu would be that bridge, I guess, that sort of vehicle that would take open source application, open source efforts, and bring it into the bring it to the masses. That was the idea. CentOS, I think, was Karen, maybe still here, was speaking about that in terms of CentOS, in terms of, you know, a lot of what they do in their distribution is pulling together those applications. So it wasn't a particularly unique idea. I think the breadth of it, I think, was unusual. I think remains unusual in terms of the scope of what they were doing. So why would the world flock to Ubuntu? Well, they hired the best marketing talent money could buy at the time in 2007, which, well, you should meet that guy, he's great. But the uniquely, Ubuntu was going to build a brand around the operating system, and a lot of what we spoke about today was as far away from brand conversation as you can possibly imagine. But this was really about, well, okay, it's probably, again, unique in terms of a pure play operating system, or a pure operating system play. I mean, Android, you can think of as a comparison, but Google do other things, I think you probably know, apart from Android, it's not a pure play for them. Firefox OS, again, Firefox is a search engine, now it's an operating system. But this was very unusually somebody taking an operating system as the sort of the flagship for all the other things that were going to follow in behind it. And Ubuntu's idea was that it would become so incredibly popular around the world that it would break down the barrier from people adopting open source applications. Ubuntu would do this by working directly with the manufacturers, or Canonical would, which is the company behind it. So PC manufacturers who, again, were in bed with Microsoft would understand how to engage with and how to ship and how to distribute an open source operating system. And this is an internal joke, wave hands. Somehow everyone would make a lot of money selling this free operating system to, and I mean, I'm not exaggerating, that was literally what the presentation, and then we're gonna make a lot of money. And everyone's still going, yeah, all right, you know, great. So this sounds good. So what actually happened, sorry. Open source communities were suspicious. Launchpad is now open source, but wasn't open source for a long time, which made people extremely nervous, or very good reasons for not being open source. I just can't remember what they are right now, but they were, they sounded plausible. But the net result was that people just people did not flock to the Launchpad repository, GitHub, and Bugzilla for bugs, and the Bazaar, which was a fantastic product, but just sort of slightly out of time, people started using Subversion. So there are all these actual open source tools that open source projects use rather than a closed source product, a closed source environment next to an open source operating system. PC manufacturers didn't really want to move. They were pretty happy with, you know, everyone understood the limitations of it, but everyone was making money. Unless you come to them with a proposition that was going to say, well, we're going to replace those dollars with these dollars, it was very, very difficult to get them to shift their, still is, extremely difficult to get them to shift their relationship with Microsoft. I mean, Ubuntu has succeeded in that to the degree to which I think it's possible. I think they ship on something like 8% of the world's PCs, ships into developing markets. Many of those PCs get replaced with pirated Windows, but, you know, there's only so much you can control in that environment. But it did about as much as you could do to a fairly entrenched desktop market that didn't want to shift. And now we're seeing the valuations of PC manufacturers, and we probably, you know, understand their lack of foresight and what's happening to them. The public, for all our great, my great marketing efforts, were fairly indifferent to an OS. You get past, you know, you get into, like, you think of it as concentric circles. You know, there's a core. Some of which, many of you, I don't want to label you, but many of you would represent a core of people who care about operating systems. Then there's a second group who sort of care about technology. But then when you get past that group, it's very, very difficult to explain why that core technology matters. They're much more interested in how it feels and how to use it. So how many Android phone users, for instance, really give a shit that it's an open source or whatever it is, open source type technology? Not many, but they really care about what it does. Without a product, it was very difficult for Ubuntu to make that shift, to get people to understand the concept. So that was an issue. But ultimately, I think one of the major reasons, and one of, I think, the lessons to learn, is that Ubuntu, I'll put it in the brackets, diversified into a number of different areas. So when I joined, we had Ubuntu Desktop. There just was, I think 2007 was the year of the Ubuntu Desktop, which then I usually get to laugh, but anyway. They also had Ubuntu for servers, but by the time I was coming to leave, there was was Ubuntu for server, Ubuntu for netbook, Ubuntu desktop core one, Ubuntu cloud, both guest and host OS, Ubuntu One, which was a service for delivering, or a network for delivering services, Ubuntu TV, Ubuntu Mobile, Ubuntu for ARM, Ubuntu, my favorite one, Ubuntu for in-vehicle infotainment, and then a bunch of other management services, Juju, which is a cloud orchestration tool, but still is a cloud orchestration tool. But it was becoming increasingly difficult for people. It was becoming increasingly difficult for people to understand what it is that Ubuntu is. What do you stand for? What, you know, are you, you know, for years you told us that you were going to change this desktop market. That was going to be the, you know, that was the reason you were set up. That was bug number one. But now you're going to change the cloud market. Now you're going to change the in-vehicle infotainment market. So a visitor to the website who's attracted by reading something in. I don't know if it's still going, but it used to be like a Japanese manga, Ubuntu magazine, independently produced, which, you know, did a quite good job of socializing Ubuntu into a different audience, would come to Ubuntu.com and then be told about, you know, Juju cloud orchestration on the front page. You know, people began to get very confused, and the industry began to get confused about what Ubuntu was trying to do. So, again, I will come to the lessons in a little bit. I should qualify this again and say that this is my opinion, okay? This isn't, I don't think we can write the definitive history of what Ubuntu is doing, and in many of those areas, particularly on cloud, particularly on cloud on server, building the cloud infrastructure, the host OS, the guest OS, and particularly the images they put on Amazon, which I think sort of made that, or certainly helped accelerate the adoption of Amazon Cloud to a very, very large degree, and still drives many of the world's, you know, most creative websites, startups, who are running on Amazon, who are running at Ubuntu on Amazon. So they made a lot of great technical choices, they made a lot of great technical executions, but in terms of people understanding what it is they do, I think that became less and less clear for people who engaged them in different ways. So are there lessons? I think there probably are. I haven't talked about, because it's not really my area, I'm not an expert, it's changed a bit, but the community of Ubuntu, which was huge, enormous, contributing, happy, felt they were on a mission and were building a lot of stuff, that's, I wouldn't say largely gone away, but it's certainly changed. It's certainly not as active as it used to be in terms of contribution. And again, that's because of that confusion. I think when you build a community around your project, or build a community around your OS, then people join for a reason. And if you completely change what those reasons are, or decide to dismiss their contribution as not important to what is a now changed objective, then it's very, very difficult to take those people along with you. You may feel you need to do it, but the cost of doing that can often be the loyalty and the contribution of the people who originally came on board. Focus on trying to solve a problem that people care about. Sorry, that's fairly odd. I meant to start there, because it's number one. but you know, I think that's reasonably straightforward. And everything I've heard today in terms of Jitsu and in terms of CentOS has always had it for a long time. And it's been a very, very strong, CentOS has been very, very strong at staying close to its original objective. Probably mix these up a little bit. Big companies tend to pull small companies in directions that they don't necessarily want to go. Now, I don't want to speak specifically about Ubuntu here, because it may or may not be true in some cases, but Ubuntu for TV is not a community-originated idea, right? And it takes up quite a few cycles of effort to build that, and people are a little bit confused as to why you built it, and then no one adopts it, but you spent a lot of time building it. An operating system is, you know, far better than me, isn't it? You know, they're endlessly malleable, right? They're completely fungible things. They can do almost whatever you want them to do. It's a kernel and commands. But you have to understand what problem it is that you're originally trying to solve, and anything that's not contributing towards the solution of that problem should be thrown out. Or you start a different project in order to accomplish it. I think when you have a multi-headed hydra, people again just have this difficulty in trying to get you engaged. Another one is reliance on people to get you there, and that's a notion that if I build this and then give it to I know Ian Jackson from ARM is here. I give it to someone who's a third-party organization, that they will therefore bring the success to my project that I can't bring myself. It's great to work with partners, but my observation would be, that many times that they that when it's not core to their DNA, when it's not the solution, it's not the problem that they're trying to solve, they often become less interested in that project after you delivered it, and it doesn't have an immediate impact, and you're stuck going back in time and trying to make that successful again. Stay focused on the thing that you're trying to solve, and understand that you are ultimately the people who are going to have to solve it, you and your community and the people who are contributing to it. And while others can be agents in that, they're never going to be the driver of that. It will be, it will belong to the people who are driving the project and driving the community. That's probably it, really, I think. I hope it's useful. I think it seems strange to me, and I'm glad we got this opportunity to do it. There's been a very big open source operating system project in London in the last while, so it's been great to be able to share some things that we've learned from there, that I hope won't get me sued for sharing with you. But I'll just leave it up. If there's any questions. Do we have time for questions, Justin? Or, yeah? No? Oh, yeah. I think, yes, I mean, there are lots of things you could have done differently, but I think the most obvious one is to have spun out the Ubuntu server and cloud, which still, I don't know if that's going to happen, but that's a very, very different industry, very, very different audience, very, very different set of manufacturers, a very, very different dynamic in the industry. It's totally different stage of maturity, as in PC market is incredibly mature, incredibly old, whereas the cloud and, well, not so much server, but cloud market is incredibly new. That would have made sense as a separate organization, with a separate structure around it, and still I think would make sense as a separate one. That should have been done differently. The other ones would have been just a case of going, doesn't really make a lot of sense core to what we're trying to do, and labeling it Ubuntu all the time I think just didn't wasn't helpful. I think there's a little bit of a legacy of that though from the like Zubuntu and various other flavors of Ubuntu that were. And various open source projects, that it is endlessly malleable. And it is, it's just people struggle to understand what you're doing. Okay. If I'm the last speaker, can I start a round of applause now for Justin for the organization today? And
Oh, thanks very much. I mean, I organized this because I didn't think there were enough events like this kind of thing, and it was much more than I'd hoped for. Thanks to all of you for coming, and for all the speakers for speaking and producing such an interesting set of talks. So thank you all. That's all I'm going to say now.